Ladies and gentlemen, dear audience, it's a pleasure to welcome you all to this webinar on a theme that has become very actual in recent years and certainly will stay very actual in the coming years. When you follow the press in general and the financial press in particular, there is a great chance you will find several articles on climate and sustainability. More in general, these themes have become very mainstream in thinking about future evolutions. The financial sector, being a very important part of our economic ecosystem, is of course not immune for the consequences of climate change. That's why Fabelfin and the Forum put up this webinar with the intention to draw attention to this important and very strategic topic. Even more specific, the financial sector is asked to take a responsible role in accompanying the climate transition. We can offer you a webinar in three contributions. First of all, we will give the floor to the Belgian Prudential Authority. Brenda van Tendelo and Alexander Francard of the National Bank of Belgium will explain why energy inefficient real estate exposure in the financial sector is a risk, and why data gathering on the energy efficiency is really needed. In a second contribution, Elisabeth Mignot from BNP will focus on the position of the financial institutions. Elisabeth is very well placed to take the floor in her position as president of the Fabelfin working group in question and as president of the European Mortgage Federation. The closing contribution will be brought by the Secretary General of the European Mortgage Federation. Luca Bertolot will add the international touch on this theme and will share with us the ideas of the Energy Efficient Mortgages Initiative. But ladies and gentlemen, before giving the floor to Brenda van Tendelo, I have two little practical announcements. This conference and also the PowerPoints will be registered and will be put on our website to be consulted afterwards. Second, we organize, of course, as always, a Q&A session after the conference. During the conference, you can introduce questions via the chat function of MS Teams. And after the conference, we will make a small selection of the questions that were entered. Now it's time to introduce the first speakers, Brenda van Tendelo and Alexander Francard. Brenda van Tendelo and Alexander Francard, both working at the National Bank of Belgium, but Brenda has been working with the Prudential Supervisor since 2008. In the last 4 years, she has been working on climate-related risks and sustainable finance. Within the NBB, she is the co-chair of the Climate Change and Environment Risk Hub within the NBB. Alexander Francard, also in the National Bank of Belgium since 2008, is a senior consultant, a senior coordinator for macroprudential policy, and member of various international committees. Ladies and gentlemen, I think it's now time to give the floor to Brenda. Brenda, please take the floor.
Yes, thank you, Mark. Good afternoon, everyone. So as Mark explained, my name is Brenda van Tendelo. I will be doing this presentation together with my colleague, Alexander Francard. So we both indeed work at the National Bank of Belgium in the Prudential Policy and Financial Stability Department. So as supervisors, we are concerned with the financial soundness of financial institutions and the financial system as a whole. And in this regard, we have been focusing more and more on climate-related risk over the last couple of years. And today, we focus on one specific climate-related risk, namely the transition risk that is associated with the energy efficiency of buildings. And the outline of our presentation is as follows, as indicated on the next slide. We will first explain why climate change and the transition towards a more sustainable economy can pose risks to the economy and to financial stability, and why financial institutions and supervisors therefore should be taking these risks into account. Second, we will clarify how energy efficiency can impact current and future credit risk, and as such be a risk factor for the transition risk to which the Belgian financial sector is potentially exposed. And finally, we will discuss our requirement of financial institutions to gather data related to the energy performance of buildings and include this in their risk management. So now, What is it exactly we understand by climate-related risks, and how could they affect the financial system? Climate-related risks are typically divided into two types of risks. First, if not enough action is taken fast enough, so if the transition is too slow, we will be confronted with the physical manifestation of climate change in the form of more and more severe droughts, floods, storms, etc. And this is what we call physical risk. On the other hand, if the transition towards a more sustainable economy is manifesting too abruptly, then this too can cause major losses due to abrupt structural changes in the economy. And this is what we call transition risks. And they are typically caused by abrupt changes in policy or consumer and investor preferences or technological innovations. As such, both physical and transition risks can impact the financial system directly in various ways, because the financial system is exposed to various economic actors that could be impacted by these risks, hereby potentially impacting credit risk, market risk, etc. of these financial institutions. So if we take, for example, an example of physical risk impacting real estate, buildings that are situated in areas that are prone to flooding, they could see their value decrease if the risk of flooding increases due to climate change, which would then impact the value of the houses used as collateral for mortgage loans, hereby impacting the credit risk of the financial institutions. In terms of transition risk, if we take again the example of real estate, residents of buildings that are not performing well in terms of insulation and energy performance, they could see their energy costs increase due to increased energy prices, for instance, hereby impacting the repayment capacity of borrowers living in these buildings, again, increasing credit risk. As another example, companies that are engaged in activities that are controversial, such as fossil fuel financing, they might see their reputation and businesses impacted or might even be subject to legal claims, as in the case of Shell, for example. And this could impact the credit risk of the financial institutions providing loans to this company, or it could also impact market risk if shares of this company are included in the trading portfolio of the bank. And when the bank is financing these activities, this could also directly lead to reputation damages of the financial institution that is financing this activity. And next to this direct impact, climate and environmental risks can also have an indirect impact on the financial system through a general economic deterioration because of a decrease in output and demand. On the other hand, losses generated in the financial system, they can also feed back into the real economy because, for instance, banks are more reluctant to lend money and therefore increase their lending standards. But physical and transition risks are, of course, interrelated, as shown in the next slide. As mentioned before, physical risks will manifest especially if not enough action is taken fast enough. So sharp increases in economic losses from weather-related events, they may trigger more abrupt policy responses, resulting in higher transition risks. In the least favorable scenario, extreme climate-induced damages as a result of long delays in the transition will eventually force a sudden and radical change in the economy. Now, there is, of course, a lot of uncertainty regarding these risks. It all depends on what kind of policy measures are being taken, which technological innovations are being developed, and how market sentiment can change. And this means that countless scenarios are possible. But what is clear is that in order to avoid both physical and transition risks, there is a need for a gradual transition. And for that, we need a coherent and firm climate policy with clear actions that are communicated well in advance in order for every market participant to be able to prepare for the changes that inevitably have to come. Next slide. So as climate change and the transition to a more sustainable economy, especially if this happens abruptly, as this can have a huge impact on the entire economy and consequently can also impact financial stability, therefore, climate-related risks have been an important point of attention for several years now for regulators, central banks, and supervisors, including the National Bank of Belgium. And a necessary condition for the adequate measurement, evaluation, and management of these risks is, of course, the availability of the necessary data. And this requires a taxonomy with uniform definitions of what is sustainable and what is not. Now, the European Commission has already developed a taxonomy to identify those activities that are considered to be contributing to the climate objectives, and they will elaborate this taxonomy further to also include the environmental objectives. Now, for us, it's however not only important to identify which activities are sustainable or green, but also to identify those activities that are very harmful to the climate and the environment. And the planned extension of the taxonomy to include also the identification of these harmful activities would therefore be very useful from a risk perspective. Also, a standardized framework for public disclosure of information regarding the sustainability and risks associated with activities is crucial in this regard. In order for financial institutions to have the necessary data to assess the risks of their exposures, it's important that their counterparties are also disclosing information on the sustainability and risks of their activities. In particular, the Corporate Sustainability Reporting Directive, of which a proposal was published in April earlier this year, that will play an important role in this regard. In terms of risk management, the National Bank of Belgium, as well as the European Central Bank, they have already published a number of recommendations for financial institutions and the European supervisory authorities, as well as on an international level, the Basel Committee for Banking Supervision and the International Association for Insurer Supervisors are currently examining how the regulatory framework should be adapted to better take into account these risks in the context of risk management. In addition, a number of scenario analysis and stress tests have already been performed, and additional stress tests are still being planned. And also, both private and public initiatives are currently looking into the best ways to assess these risks and tackle data gaps, and are developing methodologies to assess and measure these risks, including methodologies for scenario analysis and stress testing, which are crucial in assessing these risks, given the uncertainty. And more data on the energy efficiency of buildings will soon be available via the NBB circular, as we will explain later in this presentation. And finally, it's being examined whether the capital requirements may have to be adjusted to take into account climate and environmental risks. But here it's very important to note that capital requirements and prudential regulation in general, they need to be risk-based at all times. So no lower capital requirements for green investments or loans just to encourage them. A lower capital requirement is only justified if it can be demonstrated that these assets also represent lower risks. And we are currently actively contributing to all of these regulatory and supervisory developments in several European and international working groups. In the next slide, one of the reasons that we are focusing on real estate is that buildings are a major contributor to greenhouse gas emissions in Belgium. As you can see in this graph, more than 20% of total emissions come from households, and more than half of those emissions stem from heating and cooling and are thus dependent on the energy efficiency of the houses. And of course, also commercial buildings contribute to greenhouse gas emissions. Next slide. With regard to residential real estate, it appears that Belgian households have on average much higher emissions for heating and cooling compared to our neighboring countries or the European average. If you have a look at the energy efficiency of Belgian residential buildings that have been built, sold or rented out over the period of 2010 to 2019, as indicated in the figure on the right, it appears that energy efficiency is indeed very low. When we consider only buildings to have an energy consumption of below 100 kilowatt hour per square meter per year, which is generally the goal set for 2050, then percentages are really, really low. Now, these data only take into account those buildings that are newly built, rented out or sold over the last 10 years. So it's expected that the energy efficiency of the overall housing stock is even worse. On the other hand, renovation might also have taken place after the transaction for older houses. So this would mean that for some houses included in this database, the energy efficiency is better than portrayed in the energy performance certificate. So it's estimated overall that about 95% of the entire building stock would need to be renovated by 2050. And the poor energetic performance could be explained because in Belgium, we have relatively more independent houses compared to apartments, which tend to perform better in terms of energy efficiency. Our buildings also tend to be rather old, and we also have above average living space for all income classes. Next slide. More and more policy measures are already directed at reducing greenhouse gas emissions, and they are becoming increasingly ambitious. And the European Union aims to be climate neutral, meaning that the European economy needs to have net zero greenhouse gas emissions by 2050, with a 55% reduction of greenhouse gas emissions by 2030. And part of those measures includes the further strengthening of the emissions trading system, with increased carbon prices as a consequence. So further increases are still to be expected. Next slide. Now, it's clear that all European countries will have to take additional measures in order to reach the goals set by the Paris Agreement and the EU targets for 2030 and 2050. But which precise policy actions are to be taken is to date, however, not yet entirely clear. Next slide. According to Hans Bruinings, the director of the European Environment Agency, Belgium is one of the countries with the biggest policy gap with regard to 55% greenhouse gas reductions to be reached by 2030. And in the Belgian Energy and Climate Plan for 2021 to 2030, and also in its long-term strategy for 2050, buildings and the transport sector are both mentioned as being the most important sectors for taking further measures to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in Belgium. And also in the European Green Deal, renovation of both public and private buildings has been singled out as a key initiative to drive energy efficiency and to deliver on the objectives. Now, as real estate apparently has a major contribution to greenhouse gas emissions in Belgium and has also been identified as a potential target for additional policy measures directed at reducing these emissions, a minimum energy performance for buildings is a likely policy measure to be taken in Belgium. As in the Netherlands, for instance, where commercial buildings must meet a minimum energy standard from 2023 onwards, or in the UK, where property with an energy performance certificate ratings in the lowest categories may not be rented out anymore. So, but also other measures, like for instance, a carbon tax, they are deemed to be likely policy measures to be taken and are thus potential candidates to be taken into account for scenario analysis. Next slide. And real estate is not only a major contributor to greenhouse gas emissions and therefore potentially subject to additional policy measures and transition risk, but they also represent a very large share in Belgian financial institutions' assets. And in order to capture transition risks, we focus on climate policy relevant sectors, which are those sectors that are emission intensive sectors, as these are the sectors that will most likely be targeted by policy measures directed at reducing these greenhouse gas emissions. And for banks, we focus on the non-financial corporate loans portfolio and mortgages. And if we combine the non-financial corporate loans and the mortgages, at the end of 2020, about 65% can be considered as climate policy relevant. Of course, all mortgages are by nature exposed to transition risks. And if we look at NFCs, also the non-financial corporates only, then 39% of those loans are considered to be climate relevant, with the bulk of these exposures also being housing loans. Next slide. If we have a look at the banking exposures of non-financial corporates, to non-financial corporates at a European level, we again see a very large part of the exposures being in the real estate sector. For the insurance sector then, on the next slide. In 2019, 54% of equities, 48% of corporate bonds, and 36% of loans are in sectors that are considered to be exposed to transition risks. And as we can see, also for the insurance sector, these exposures are most important in the real estate sector. And on the next slide, at the aggregate level, 56% of these assets are in sectors exposed to transition risk, which is in line with the European average. Now, this sector classification is, of course, a first approximation of the magnitude of the transition risk exposure. So there can, of course, be important discrepancies in the ecological footprints of the forests belonging to the same sector. So actually, a more granular analysis is warranted, and other tools such as the Greenhouse Gas Protocol tool or the PACTA tool developed by the 2° investing initiatives, they allow for a more granular analysis. Next slide. Because of the relevance of real estate exposures in the transition risk of Belgian financial institutions, We have focused our attention in the first instance towards these climate change related transition risks associated with real estate exposures, and have included therefore a thematic article on this topic in the NBB Financial Stability Report of 2020. The article identifies the energy efficiency of real estate exposures as an important risk factor for the transition risk. And this can be explained as follows. Strict regulations on the energy performance of buildings, they could be severely impacted by the value of buildings used as collateral for these loans. And if the necessary adjustments are not made to meet the new standards due to a lack of resources for the additional investment, or the inability to find a construction firm due to the high demand caused by a new measure, or simply because people are not willing to make the investment, then the value of these energy efficient buildings could be severely affected. Now, as regulation becomes stricter and potentially also energy prices continue to increase, people will become more and more aware of the relevance of energy performance, impacting the value of the houses even further. And a lower value of the collateral would mean that if the counterparty defaults, then the loss incurred by the financial institutions could increase. In addition, households or businesses residing in energy-intensive buildings, they could also see their heating costs increase when energy prices increase, hereby impacting their ability to repay on the mortgage debt. And of course, strict regulation requiring minimum energy performance levels of buildings could also oblige building owners to make additional investments to bring these buildings up to code. And the worse the energy efficiency of the building, the larger these investments would have to be. And both these elements could negatively impact the repayment capacity of mortgage holders, hereby increasing their probability of default. Next slide. Several studies have already provided some evidence indicating that energy efficiency could be an important risk factor for the transition risk of real estate exposure. For instance, for the collateral value, it has been shown that energy efficiency is currently already a determining factor for the price of real estate. The time it takes to sell the more energy efficient house also appears to be considerably shorter. The price difference for energy efficient houses has also widened over time, which is consistent with the assumption that people are becoming more and more aware of the relevance of energy efficiency in their homes. And the pricing of energy standards is also higher for high income groups, more expensive houses, and in the capital region compared to other regions. And also with regard to the probability of default, evidence points towards energy efficient mortgages having lower payment arrears, and mortgages on A-rated buildings appear to be less likely to default. And now Alexandre will continue.
Okay, so we've seen with what Brenda just mentioned that it's quite likely that measures will be taken to reduce the footprint of real estate. And then the question comes, what will be the impact on the financial sector if we end up in a scenario where stricter standards are applied in an abrupt way, where energy costs are rising? So to try and answer this question, we can use a forward-looking analysis, and the schematic view that will be presented on this slide, it actually builds on the research that Brenda just mentioned and on the assumptions that were also shown in the previous slide. And so if we end up in such a scenario, what we'll see an impact from the probability of defaults, the reasons were mentioned already by Brenda. Also an impact on the loss given default, and so potentially that would lead to higher credit losses. So in a scenario analysis, you will have to take forward-looking assumptions, of course. As Brenda mentioned, we see that there's already now a difference in price between energy efficient and energy inefficient houses, but looking forward, one could say that the premium we already see now that it will become bigger. So to try and assess what the losses could be, you should use several scenarios, including some where the transition is not timely and is not gradual. The vulnerabilities that are related, let's say, to the transition, they could be amplified as regards for the probability of default. For instance, if we see an initially weaker repayment capacity, let's say an initially larger vulnerability to income shocks for those households that are living in inefficient dwellings, and for the loss given default, if we see initially looser credit standards, for instance, lower loan to value ratio. So in the end, to be able to do such an exercise, it's important to first know the energy efficiency of the real estate exposures, to be able to identify the energy inefficient exposures, and two, to combine this data with other risk indicators. So far, these data are usually missing, so there's a need for more data on this. And in this regards, the NBB has taken several initiatives to encourage the financial sector to collect TPC data. The first ones were, let's say, soft ones, more creating or reinforcing awareness through reports or through letters. And the second one, Brenda already alluded to this one, was a circular that was published and that clarified the expectations of the NBB as regards such data collection. By the way, this circular is publicly available on the NBB website. And there you can read that the NBB asks financial institutions to gather energy performance information for new loans that are financing real estate or that are collateralized or guaranteed by real estate. Also for recent loans, we don't ask information, for instance, for very older loans, because there we take the assumption that a significant part has already been reimbursed and that the potential for credit losses is lower. And there's part of this information that is then that needs to be reported to the NBB as well. Ideally, of course, the financial institution should have a direct access to the EPC databases. But that's not the case yet. NBB is supporting the sector in its effort to try and obtain such an access. At the moment, it's ongoing. It remains uncertain. But that's why financial institutions should not wait and start gathering information on their own. Already know. The circular from the NBB, it's part of a broader sets of initiatives, let's say, taken by the NBB as regards real estate exposures. Until now, they were not really focusing on climate related issues, more on lending standards and resilience of the banking sector. Of course, the NBB is not the sole institution asking for such energy efficiency information for real estate, but well, among the first one, let's say, to have a specific inquiry in this regards. And the reason is that with our macroprudential mandate, and Brenda also referred to it, so we have a mission to maintain financial stability, and given the importance of real estate exposure in Belgium, well, it's just logical that we have to take into account the potential risk for financial stability related to the transition. And to be clear, it's not the transition in itself that's the risk, but more the risks surrounding this transition, especially if it comes late or abruptly. The main goal for this collection of EPC data is that the financial institutions are able to analyze and to assess the heights of the of this risk in their portfolios. EPC values might be imperfect, but it's say the best tool we have. And as you can also read in the Q&A that's annexed to the NBB circular, we encourage institutions to take into account all the forward-looking information they can have. For instance, in cases of renovation. Just a word also to mention that the EPC information, it will be needed by the financial institutions for several other initiatives. Could be expectations from the ECB, which is the supervisor for the larger banks in the euro area. Also, as regards disclosures that were mentioned by Brenda, also in the light of the forthcoming stress test for sorry, for 2022. Okay, on this slide, what we can see, it comes from the partial reporting, the first partial reporting that we received from the institutions at the NBB. We can have an idea of what such data would allow to do. Directly here, I have to say that that's a very important caveat. So these data are very partial. They were reported on a best effort basis so far, and they certainly cannot be considered as representative for the Belgian financial sector, especially if we see, for instance, in our reporting that there's still a very large part of the new loans that for which the financial institutions actually do not have the APC data yet. But still, okay, that gives an idea of what it could provide as information. And then with this, we actually already cover the first part of the information we should need in a scenario analysis, which is be able to identify the energy efficient and inefficient exposures. On the next slide, then we try to capture the second part of the data we were looking after in our scenario analysis. On the left-hand side, we can see a breakdown of the loan service to income ratio. So that's the share of the monthly income that is used to reimburse the mortgage loan of households, and that according to different EPC scores here. Here we can see tentatively again that there are different risk factors that could amplify each other. So we see that people financing a dwelling with the A label have on average a lower loan service to income than others, which means that they could absorb bigger future income shocks than other households. But as we mentioned, the impact on the reimbursement capacity or the probability of default from, for instance, a higher energy cost is expected to be bigger for the lower EPC scores in the future. So to sum up here, the current situation is a bit worse now for exposure, which are expected to be hit to a larger extent in the future in the design scenario. And the same seems to be true if we have a look at the right-hand side for loan to values. Again, these charts are built on very incomplete data. Results should not be considered as representative, but they allow to see what use could be done of EPC data to assess transition risk for residential exposure. Okay, now I just have to conclude for this part of the webinar, repeating some of the main messages that were conveyed. Real estate is an important contributor to greenhouse gas emissions in Belgium. As a result, further measures to reduce these emissions are quite likely. At the same time, real estate exposures is a very important part of the Belgian financial sector assets. So the combination actually of these two statements, it explains why it's a point of attention for the NDB and potentially a threat for financial stability looking forward. That's also why climate-related transition risk need to be duly taken into account by financial institutions. And to do this, we believe there's a need to collect data on energy performance. Thank you for your attention. Back to you, Mark.
Thank you, Brenda, and thank you, Alexander, for your very extensive analysis of the concerns of the prudential authorities. But this webinar is built with two other angles of attack, very complementary. We want to give the floor to the financial sector, and we want to present you Elisabeth Mignot. Elisabeth Mignot is responsible at BNP for the implementation of all sustainable and legislative changes in the field of consumer and mortgage credits. She is very well placed to give us a vision on the financial sector because she is president of the working group of FABELFIN on retail credits and sustainable loans, and she is president of the European Mortgage Federation. There's no one better than Elisabeth can present us an opinion, a vision of the financial sector. Please, Elisabeth, take the floor.
Thank you very much. So as what we already heard, we urgently need to tackle the issue of climate change and especially the CO2 emissions that are caused by residential buildings. And this is what we are focusing on in our Commission on Sustainable Loans within UPC, FABELFIN. Just to resituate some figures in Belgium, we know that 20% of the emissions are coming from the residential real estate. So this is quite substantial, knowing that transport counts around about for 23%. After a recent study, we also saw that in Belgium, the renovation rate should go much more up. It's now being estimated at 0.2% by year for the profound energetic renovations, and for the normal energetic renovations to 1% a year, which is not enough. If you look at Flanders, for example, they calculated, the Flemish government calculated that to, in order to achieve the objectives for in 2050, we need around about 80 to 100,000 renovations per year, which is much higher than what we have today, knowing that this would cost around 50 to 55,000 euros a year. You see that these are huge amounts that need to be invested in this energetic renovations for residential buildings. Just for information, today we have around about 3.5% of the residential real estate in Flanders, which is according to the objectives, which is label A, according to the objectives for 2050. In Wallonia, we know that we also need a certain renovation rate. There we talk about 3%, so which brings us to around about 45,000 houses a year. So this is also really substantial, and in Brussels the same. We know that we have very many historical buildings in Brussels, and we see that 92% of the residential buildings are from before 1970, so definitely not energetically very efficient. So going further, I can make this work. Yes, we have here the Retail Credit Sustainable Loans Committee of UPC, and we are already very active since 2017 with some major credit institutions, and you see all of them here, and we are working really, really hard around this energy efficiency for the reasons that were exposed, the transition risks, etc., but also to see how, as a financial sector, which is financing the economy, how can we really stimulate these energy efficient loans? Because we also see it as our role to be a partner towards the clients and guide them towards these realities. They must know that they will have certain norms to which they will have to have their housing in the future. So we meet around monthly or two times a month. We also interact with many stakeholders. So I think it's too many to name, but we were also very active, and Luca will definitely tell something more about it, in the Energy Efficiency Mortgage Initiative by the European Mortgage Federation. We have been interacting with the European Commission, with the local governments, with other stakeholders in the market. So the main question for us is, how can we play a role as financial sector in stimulating energy efficiency? And so looking at that, we did a couple of studies, and there's studies existing as well, in which we looked at what do Belgians say about the why they do not renovate their house to become more energy efficient. And mostly people say they have a lack of funds. We also say that many people think that something should be done to tackle the climate change, but it shouldn't cost too much. And usually they think they do not, they cannot on their own impact this transition. And so this is really very flagrant, because we see that really in the audience awareness is lacking, and awareness is really important to make sure that people do really want to do this energy efficient renovations. And going to awareness, we know that EPCs are getting more and more common. People know about it while buying a house, but there's still a lack of availability of energy efficient houses, as I said before. And for this, what we see important as financial sector is to have the government support and really have some measures. And I think looking at what Suhail Demir said, she really, really wants some clear measures to be working, so we should be really showing to people that energy efficiency is important and will count more and more for reasons of course avoiding that you have a very energy inefficient house and you will be penalized later. But even looking at the energy prices that rise, it is very relevant for people to reduce this energy consuming houses and to really make sure that we have some real investments to make things more energy efficient. We know that, and it was also mentioned by Brenda before, the value energy efficiency is already directly correlated to the value. So the study that was done by the Catholic University of Leuven in Flanders in 2018 has shown that a house that is energy efficient is already 10.9% more expensive than a house in the same localization. For apartments, this is a bit less significant, but 10.9% is really a lot. And that is why we do this as a conviction as banks to make sure that we improve energy efficiency. Also, we take this into account in our risk policies, and knowing that we have these mortgages on our books, we want to make sure that these mortgages are as energy efficient as possible. So EPC is really a central information that is being used already now by all banks, and that we really start, even though it is still manual, collecting from our customers when they come to us requiring for a loan. Just a short side note, but I think Luca will talk more about the Energy Efficient Mortgage Initiative and the label, which is there for the banks that really want to make visible what they are doing with the energy efficient mortgages, and really want to show how many mortgages really are aligned to the standards that are set by the European Commission. So looking further, I mean, this is not the only thing we are looking at. Another element is also the quality of the EPCs. we know that this has evolved a lot, and I think that one of the points that we only have to collect EPCs for the National Bank as of 2017 onwards is also because we know that over the last few years the quality has improved a lot, and there are much more stringent controls in the EPCs that are being audited, the houses that are being audited. And so this is really important, because we need to make sure that we base ourselves on the good values, and that if we want to do an audit on ourselves, that it corresponds with the value that has been given on the official certificate. And so what was also mentioned is the digital link to databases, as mentioned by Alexander. This is really crucial. Why is just first of all to make things more efficient and to have a smooth process, but also to avoid data quality issues. Sometimes people are not already having the EPC on hand when they come to ask for a loan. Sometimes it's only given later on when they sign a notarial deed. And so having direct access to the EPC databases really allows us to have the right figures. And then you could go even further in seeing, okay, how is it, for example, how are certain houses evolving? But to have a digital link to EPC databases, of course, we need a unique identifier. And what do we mean by that? Is that we need to be able to see how we can link the house, the good in our database to the EPC score in the database of the governments. And so today this is still based on address, but it can give sometimes very strange situations or street names that are not written exactly the same in each database, or in the case of apartments, there it is really, really tough to make this direct link. So this is really also if we want to really make this process much more fluid, then this is a very crucial element, and we need to be able to see, preferably with a federal unique identifier if possible, how we can link directly the EPC values in the official databases to our own database. So this is a final one. How about apartments? And this is really a very special one. I mean, most of the housing is single property, is our houses, but there's also the condominiums, and this is a question we are posing ourselves, because very often in order to really implement some energy efficiency measures, a house owner living in from apartment buildings cannot do this on his own. For example, we quickly talk about changing windows, doing isolation on the roof, putting solar panels, using heat pumps. So this is really also one of the topics we still breaking our heads about. How will we tackle that? How can we tackle that? How can a co-property be obliged to do certain energy efficiency investments? And so how can they decide much quicker to do this type of investments? So this is I think the overall topics we are tackling within the financial sector. As I said, there's a lot of challenges, but I think in the last few years we already achieved quite a lot. We are working together with the National Bank, with the local governments, to see how can we really stimulate this energy efficiency, stimulate the renovations within the Belgian market. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Elizabeth, for your very complimentary view of the financial sector. It's quite reassuring that the vision of the financial sector is not contradictory with the vision of the previous speakers. So we can go to the third contribution in this very interesting webinar. The third contribution is coming from the international scene. It's a pleasure to have with us Luca Bertalotte. Luca Bertalotte is Secretary General of the European Mortgage Federation. And in this function, one of his roles, he is representing the interests of the EU mortgage lenders and the covered bond community in the discussions with the European institutions. He is very well placed to give us an impression of the international scene. But we are quite interested to hear his vision about the energy efficient mortgage initiative, of whom he is the consortium coordinator. Please, Luca, take the floor.
Thank you very much, Mark. It's a great honor for us to take the floor today, which is only a few days before the COP26, which probably will align a global positioning against climate change and trying to coordinate the activities of different sectors. Today is also an important day because yesterday the European Commission adopted the official proposal of Basel III, which has a huge impact to all our banks and all the financial sector in Europe. And in the adoption of the Basel III framework, there is an important recognition of the role of energy efficiency mortgages, because banks in the CRR will be allowed to refresh the evaluation of the building in case of energy efficiency renovation, which will allow banks to concretely update the loan to value, the LTV. And this has an important prudential implication for the entire sector. Also, another news of this morning is the Bank of England this morning announced that they will revisit the capital charge for the banking sector in function of the climate risk. So a few days before COP26, we see that important developments have occurred in the financial sectors. And we, as a European Mortgage Federation, we believe that this is the right direction. And we would like to give some concrete highlights of what we are doing at the European level in order to actually develop a global initiative which can help the contribution and support the contribution of the financial sectors to the climate transition and help to reduce gas emissions. As we all know, the gas emission of the housing sectors is playing a very important role in the general pollution of our continent. And this is we have to see this as also an opportunity to improve not only our pollution levels, but also the quality of life of European citizens. We know that more than 220 million of dwellings in Europe are not compliant with the energy performance requirements of the European Union. And this can make the difference for more than 450 million of European citizens and can really help the European Union in meeting the targets of Fit for 55, which has been agreed in July by the European Commission. The housing sector has the potential to really improve the quality of life of European citizens. As Alexandre mentioned today, we believe that energy efficiency has a strong impact on the probability of default, on the disposable income of European citizens, but also on the quality of their life, which means also in the value of their properties. Housing costs are an important factor for all the European citizens. And I would like just to show these slides, which represent two categories of the European citizens. The blue line that you see is we can consider the European citizens with a more fragile income levels, and the gray one is the European citizens with a less fragile income levels. As you can see, a housing cost is an important component, especially for the fragile component of our society. If we can help them in managing energy costs and reduce the energy costs, we believe that we will improve the disposable income in the part of our economy and our society where it is more needed, allowing people to invest more in education, to invest more disposable income in more essential sector of their life, but more importantly, to manage a crisis situation. We have done studies on this. We have together with, and I would like to thank the Belgian community for the support that they have provided to the collection of data. We have analyzed different situations in the Netherlands, in Italy, in Belgium, in the Nordics, in Finland. And all these studies are demonstrating the same result, that there is a significant relevant correlation, negative correlation, between energy efficiency and risk of the asset, of the collateral. This is an important information because this is allowing us to analyze for the first time the risk, the energy risk intrinsic in the asset and the balance sheet of the banks. We have one major problem is the collection of EPC data. I think that Belgium, considering the different regions of Belgium, is in a very good situation because anyhow in Belgium, you are in a better place in comparison with other countries. EPC are actually a common instrument in Belgium, and an important part of the Belgian stock has, one third, I would say, has some kind of information around the EPC. I'm saying this because, I mean, Belgium has also a challenge, is that having a regional structures, the collection of EPC are anyhow challenging, like in every single country, so like for example in Germany or in Spain or in Italy, where the collection of the EPC data is done on a regional basis. We as a federation, we are supporting our banks by providing legal advice on how EPC can be used and can be disclosed on common disclosures. We are also providing common templates for banks in order to collect energy efficiency data. This will be extremely important in the upcoming months when the taxonomy will be implemented and some important regulatory decision will be taken in order to help banks in taking action in the energy efficiency sector. As you can see, we have on the right hand side of my slide, you can see a few information about the EPC levels in the different countries in Europe. If you would take an example, for example, just in Spain, more than 85% of the housing stock is actually absolutely not energy performant. What is the implication for a family? Well, we all know that, I mean, the building stocks in Europe, but also in Belgium, is quite old. We can consider very easily that all the houses built after 2090, they need a serious energy renovation of the house. We can see that in generally in Europe, the situation is quite challenging. That's why the European Commission has put in place a massive strategy, which is the renovation strategy, to help European citizens in renovating their house. In Belgium, we have done a focus on the Belgian situation, and looking at the different Belgian cities, you can see that in average, we are, I will say, 80% of the houses in our cities, they need to be renovated. What does it mean, a renovation for a family? Well, for a renovation for a family, it means spending in average in Europe between 20 and 25,000 of euros to allow the family to move the building to up of two energy efficiency level. What does it mean for the family? It means that the family probably can save between 50 and 70% of the energy bill cost, improving the disposable income, but also defending quite importantly the value of their properties. We are looking since 5 years on valuation numbers, and it's very interesting to see what is the impact of the energy performance renovation in a building. If you make a jump of two energy performance categories, you can actually increase the property value of the building of even 8-10% if you move out the building from G on F, and also if you arrive in categories like A or B. This is a very substantial help for the banks, of course, because I mean the LTV will be improved importantly, but also in the quality of life of citizens. We have to help consumers to renovate their house. So from my, that's my personal view, but I think that the more green mortgages are not enough. The banks should keep themselves with a lot of instruments that can help consumers to make the renovation. Also, as I said, the amount, the average amount in Europe is a tiny amount, is 20,000-25,000. And sometimes this amount can be included, of course, in the mortgages, but can also be done as a consumer loan. This is an important dynamic that we are analyzing and is a trend which is helping the our initiative at the global level to develop the right solution for the consumers. What we are doing in Europe, we have created an energy efficiency mortgage label, which is a clear instrument to provide clarity and transparency to lenders, to investors and consumers. Whatever product, financial product, will help consumers to improve the energy efficiency of their house will be labeled, and the banks using this label will be obliged to provide disclosures on a common European standard, which is becoming a global standard. This will help the banks not only to give clarity and transparency on the asset side of the balance sheet of the banks, but also will help banks directly to build green liabilities on the funding side, on the liability side of the banks. This will prevent greenwashing and will help investors to have very clear, standardized best practices in terms of disclosures. We believe that this will trigger a new global attention to energy efficiency product and will really guide banks in a new common disclosure experiment, which will facilitate IT disclosures for banks and also reducing costs for banks in terms of retail and funding costs. But the real opportunity here for me is on the marketing that the banks can have. Being an essential cog in improving the quality of life of citizens is an important driver from a marketing point of view, but also will improve the reputational quality of the role of banks in the society. And we take this with a lot of responsibility and seriousness, and we are really trying to help banks in having a common approach from Sweden till Malta and from Lisbon till Athens, having a common approach. The European Central Banks, not only the ECB in Frankfurt, but also all the national banks, are following us very closely. And I would like to thank the Belgian community, especially Elizabeth, for guiding the Belgian National Hub, because we are trying to implement our initiative by using national support and asking local stakeholders to build a new ecosystem, putting together national support subsidies coming from local authorities and market incentives. This is, I think, an important way to develop a common strategy and to put together the efforts of the private sector and public sectors. The European Union has to spend probably more than 250 billion per year in order to comply with the targets set in Fit for 55. And we believe that capital markets can really help governments, states, citizens in renovating their house. That's our target. We want to make the renovation a comfortable experiment and help citizens in getting the right decision and making the right investment in their house. We invest in changing life, and we all know that after COVID, the house has become the most important place of our life and our working career. So we need to improve the capacity of the financial sectors to support our citizens. Mark, I would like to conclude and give maybe a bit more room for the debate, which will follow the discussion. Please let me know if you want me to focus more on the international aspect or if you want me to give a bit more room for the debate afterwards. I follow your instruction here.
Luca, there is no room for 5 or 10 minutes for you without a problem.
Okay, so allow me
but
to...
But your presentation is not shared anymore. I don't know if it's important.
I concluded the slides that I wanted to show, but I would like to give you an overview of what we are doing at the international level. This is not only a European initiative, but I mean, we are also working very closely with the IMF and the World Bank to allow other countries to use our templates and implement this at international level. We are working very close with Brazil, and Canada, Indonesia, and other countries, Australia, Japan, in order to disseminate the same best practices that we are deciding at European level. We know that this is a global challenge. We need to provide global solutions because it's not Europe is only counting 7% of the global population. So if we fix the problem in Europe, we will not fix the global problem. We also believe that by having this global approach, we can really build a new investor base for energy efficiency products. And this will help our banks in producing green covered bonds, green securitization, and green debt unsecured. We know that capital markets and capital markets union can be an important leverage to develop a new cash flows and allow banks to refinance their portfolio quite quickly and rapidly, and also in a more stable way. This is a link not only to the mortgages, but we are also trying to include an SME component, because small and medium enterprises are playing an important role in the renovation of the houses. Small and medium enterprises can advise banks on the right works that can be done in the house, can also guarantee the work done to the banks, and more importantly, can plug in data for the quality of the house. For example, here in Europe, you don't have an obligation to provide an EPC if you renovate your house, but it will be very helpful if banks could get the EPC automatically if there is an energy renovation of the house. So small and medium enterprise doing the renovation of the house can actually feed automatically EPC data to the bank. And the bank then can use this data in a new way and build green covered bonds, green securitization, green bonds in general with this information. So what we are doing, and we are testing this in Trento and in Scotland, we would like to build an ecosystem where automatically the small and medium enterprise working around the banks can feed this information and improve the quality of the works for the bank, but also giving advice to consumer on how to build an energy efficiency solution for their life and automatically improve the quality of their life, of their house. What is happening around Europe? In Belgium, but also in other countries, there are a lot of discussion about inserting cap on energy efficiency limit on houses. For example, in France, but that was also discussion here in Belgium, in the Flemish regions, there was the idea, and in France, they are discussing in the parliament to introduce a limit for renting properties below G by 2025 and below F by 2028. This will have a huge impact on the value of the houses. In the Netherlands, it's already the case for commercial properties below C. So this is the future, and we have to prepare the financial sector to this challenge. We should help citizens in make the right investment in the coming years to avoid to arrive to have a diesel car nowadays. I think that we all have this experience that if you have a diesel car, you are thinking how to sell it or how to get a car which is not a diesel. Well, that probably will be the case also for houses, where we need to make the right investment now to prevent a loss in our best investment, because the house at the end of the day is the most important investment that we have. Probably the banks will help us. And we have developed this energy efficiency mortgage label, which is a way to make this very transparent, very accessible. Consumer can go on the website and then they can find all the information about the energy efficiency banks providing this data. Allow me very quickly, Mark, to maybe share very quickly the website to show concretely what we have done. If you see here, this is the website providing all the information, and it's very easy to have access to all the label banks that have accepted to be on board. As you can see, we have most of the major banks around Europe. We have 31 banks for the time being. 10 Dutch banks are about to join us in the coming days. Allow me to say a big thank you to BNP Paribas, because we have all the branches of BNP Paribas around Europe. And there is a special thank you for Elizabeth here. But all the major banks have put their green product. Banks, allow me to show what a bank can do from a prudential point of view. We are asking banks to provide full disclosure of their database so investors can enter in every single bank, and they can have a complete vision of the taxonomy compliant portfolio of a bank. They can analyze, for example, the geographical background by region. They can have, for example, the breakdowns by kind of a repayment, for example, by LTV buckets. So all the due diligence of investors can be easily done on our website, and you can compare this bank by bank, country by country, and have a complete transparent overview. We believe that this is the best way to fight greenwashing and allow investors to make their proper risk assessment. Mark, I pause here. I follow always your instructions. I can speak for hours, so stop me, please, Mark.
So if it's okay, you can conclude, Luca.
Okay, so just to conclude, we are guiding our European Mortgage Federation represent more than 2,000 banks around the globe, and we believe that we have a huge responsibility in working together with you to try to find the right way to produce all the data that are needed to the central banks and to the Ministry of Finance to make their proper assessment. We have the capacity to provide guidelines to our banks, and every single bank in Europe is doing a huge effort to try to be compliant with taxonomy, with Basel III, of course. And this is an unique opportunity, window of opportunity, to give instructions to banks and to let them work together. So I'm here to just to give this message to you. We are ready to work together. We need your voice. So if you want to play a role in our advisory council, we are more than happy to have the National Bank of Belgium active in our advisory council and work together with us to find the right solution. Thank you all for your kind attention, and thank you, Mark, for the kind invitation.
Thank you very much, Luca, for sharing with us the views from the international scene. It's a very complimentary contribution. Thank you. And indeed, a few questions have entered our boxes. So I will try to take those questions, and I will try to combine some questions. Perhaps the first question, I think, addressed to the prudential authorities. The question is the following. I presume that capital requirements for financing development in fossil fuels have the same capital requirements as investment. Why should lower capital requirements not be used for green investments? What is your position? That's the question.
Yes, I'll start, and maybe Alex can Alexander can continue. Well, it's really important that capital requirements and prudential regulation remains risk-based, because also green investments can entail risks. So for the financial stability, it's really important that prudential regulation first looks at the risks, and that all these risks are captured and duly capitalized. So for stimulating certain investments, or maybe refraining from other investments, we first look at the at the governments to stimulate these investments. So when we are currently looking into whether or not we need to adjust them. So if there is a reason, like for instance, mortgage loans, there seems to be some evidence where we can show that, okay, if there's a mortgage loan for with a building as collateral that is really energy efficient, then we can see, okay, there is a lower risk. And then it could be that these capital requirements for these loans could be lowered. So we are currently looking into, for certain specific assets, how to maybe adjust risk weights to better capture the actual risks that are entailed with these assets. But that should always be the baseline. What are the risks that are associated with the assets? If there are lower risks associated with green assets, then we can lower risk requirements. But solely just to encourage green investments, that we cannot but do, because yeah, we need to look at the risks. And if certain green investments, like for instance, new technologies that they are really green, but if they're really new, that could entail also risks if there are certain bubbles or something, we can just lower capital requirements merely to encourage these investments. So I hope that answers the question. Maybe Alexander.
Alexander, no, it was complete. Thank you. So I stay with the same orientation of questions. I think a second question for the Prudential Authority is about disclosure. The question is as follows. Disclosures, should it be at a national level, like it is enough to show the data on group level, or should it be specifically for Belgium? And when will you check this? Question of a million.
Well, we are currently already looking at disclosures, and they should, well, in the first instance, be at group level, of course, but yeah, also the specific country level activities are also relevant, of course. So there are already some regulations that ask banks and companies to disclose certain information, and we are currently already looking into it. But these regulations can be improved, of course, and that we are working on as well. So there will be improved disclosures for both banks and financial institutions in the coming years. So starting 2023 already, there will be improved disclosures that are really going into data on these risks and also the sustainability of activities. And of course, we will be looking into those and see if they are in line with the requirements.
Okay, thank you, Brenda. I have two questions for Elisabeth Mignot. I tried to combine several questions. There are a few questions about the availability of EPC data. The questions are as follows. Are these EPC databases to be built by each individual financial institution, or is there a central initiative?
Yeah.
First part, second part, these EPC data coming from publicly available databases, are there available for everyone, for the greater public? And then a question, combined question from the academic site, is it possible to get anonymous access to EPC data for doing research?
Okay. To answer the first part of the question about the EPC databases in Belgium, this is regulated in a regional manner. So this means that we have the three regions being the authority to control EPC certificates to make sure they audit the way this is done. They grant licenses to whom can make this a certificate, and they also gather all the data in their own database. So to be concrete, we have an EPC database in Flanders, we have one in Brussels, and we have one in Wallonia. What concerns the connection to the EPC databases, this is one of the topics we have been working on very hard with UPC. So here we are have developed an application interface with the Flemish region. So this API is situated centrally at Fabelfin and will communicate with the EPC database of Flanders. All the individual institutions connect separately to this central point at Fabelfin, at this central API. So this ensures us whenever we get this direct link also with the two other regions like Brussels and Wallonia, that we can do this via the same gateway. So this is the concept that we worked upon in the last couple of years, and the API got constructed this year. So this is one concrete thing, and we really try to make the connection as efficient as possible. On the other part, if I recall correctly, of the question was, can we access freely to these databases? So we can, as a citizen, we are eligible to see the EPC data of our own houses. So we can access in Flanders via the Woning Pass. What concerns Brussels is you have a website where you can actually, based on your address, go and look up your EPC data. So this is what exists with regards to the accesses. Then if you can recall me, Mark, what the third part of the question was?
The third question was about the availability of anonymous data for research.
Yes, this is a more GDPR matter, I would say, because of course we are all very interested in doing more and more studies, especially what is interesting the banks is how does the value of houses evolve over the years. How is the correlation with the EPC score and the value of houses in cities, on the countryside? How does this evolve for houses, for apartments? Because what we are thinking is that more important measures are going to be taken by governments. More important the link will be between the value of a property and the energy efficiency. Hence, this is also affecting our books, of course, because if we manage to get many energy efficient assets on our books, this is really a big stabilization factor. And we know that Brussels, when we organized a seminar back in 2019, prior to COVID, where we were still allowed to be all together in a big room. And as a sector, we invited over at BNP Paribas Fortis all sorts of speakers, of which also Brenda participated, Luca as well. We had there also the different governments explaining their politics at that time. And what was really interesting in the presentation of the Brussels region is that they really were intending to have a very firm politic, which is as of 2030, an EPC would be mandatory for every house. even if you're not selling it or renting it out. And so this has also been picked up by the real estate market. They know it very well that this is going to be an important one. And they even explained that they wanted to take it further, saying that if the EPC is worse than C in Brussels, that's around about 100 kilowatt hours, then you must be obliged, then you will be obliged to perform an energy efficient measure and to invest in your property to make it more energy efficient. And they would have this every 5 years. So this is, I think, a very interesting approach. Now I can only say what was mentioned at that time. I think the Brussels region would be more appropriate to talk more about it. But this type of measures will really also show the importance of not only for the sake of the climate, having an energy efficient house, but also, first of all, for all the citizens, because if they don't have an energy efficient house, then they will be obliged to invest. And so there the importance for the banks to also guide their customers about this when they are going to acquire their homes.
Okay, thank you. Since Mark, we are Alexander.
Compliment briefly on the first answer that Elizabeth gave, just to give the context of our circular, where actually we ask institutions to gather data on their own. So as Elizabeth mentions, an ideal world would be a direct access like the one mentioned for Flanders, for all financial institutions. That's not the case in all regions so far. And also in Flanders, it's also limited in time. So we're not there yet, but that would be ideal. In the meantime, we ask institutions to gather, let's say, information directly via their customers, and that's the aim of the NBB circular. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So we are running out of time. I want to conclude this quite very interesting webinar with two questions, one for Elizabeth and one for Luca. I will first the question for Elizabeth. It's going about the use of EPC data by banks. So the question is the following: if a bank recognizes that an energy efficiency improves the value of the house, what are the consequences? Does the bank increase the value of the collateral, or does the bank decrease the debt to income ratio?
I think that's the risk policy proper to each bank to start with. So I think what I can say in general is what we try to promote with the sector is to give a sort of an advantage to the customer in the first instance to really highlight the importance of the energy efficiency. We before applying anything in the risk policies, as the National Bank is doing as well, they are looking at real research, at real data, and see how what we can factually find. And we know that indeed the value is correlating to the energy efficiency, but every bank has to judge for himself how he's translating this in this in his own risk policy. And this is something which is not based on a hunch. It has to be based on real data.
Okay, and a final question for Luca. It's a question about greenwashing on the international scene. The question is as follows. What is your experience with greenwashing? At present, is it getting worse? Is it more present than you thought? Or is this getting better? What is your first impression?
Well, generally speaking, on greenwashing is difficult to give an answer. I mean, I think it is it's more and more present in the investor community, the request for clear data. So I think is improving the situation because investors are asking more and more very clear information about the green portfolios of banks. And I think banks are taking this very seriously. So the situation is improving because it's very, very difficult at this stage not to be aligned to taxonomy, which will be an important benchmark. And I think there is a kind of a joint effort of all the authorities, European Commission, European Central Bank, to improve the capacity of the banking sectors to reduce this, let's call this greenwashing risk. So I think all in all, to answer your question, I think the situation is improving, especially in the mortgage sector, where it's easy to give clear responses.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. With this last question, I want to conclude this very interesting webinar. I want very much thank Brenda van Tendelo, Alexander Francard, Elisabeth Mignot and Luca Bertelot for their contribution and for the answers on the questions. I thank the audience for their presence, and I want to invite our audience for the next webinar we organize. It will be on the 16th of November, and it will go about 2 decades of monetary policy at the European Central Bank. So thank you very much for your contribution, your presence. Thanks, Fabelfin, for their assistance in the organization of this webinar. And I see you, I'd like to see you next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.